Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mark Dirks, and on behalf of ACRL and Choice, I'd like to welcome you to today's program, Women, Their Jobs, and Their Lives, A History of Records from Charlotte Perkins Gilman to the Me Too Movement, which is sponsored by ProQuest. Today's discussion is one in a series of sponsored webinars from ACRL and Choice that addresses new ideas, developments, and products of interest to the academic library community. Reedy users, the structured 60-minute live presentations allow for the opportunity for interactive discussions of important new issues and developments in academic librarianship by librarians, vendors, authors, and other interested stakeholders. Before we get started, I would just like to point out a few features of the webinar software. In the main area of the screen, you should be able to follow along with the presentation materials. Along the right-hand side, you may see a Q&A panel and a chat panel. To find the chat panel, you can click the little dialogue cloud button at the bottom of your screen to open that up. Please use the Q&A panel to submit questions to our speaker today, Jill. At the end of the presentation, she'll take a little time to answer as many of your questions as we have time for, so please do send your questions in throughout. And if you're experiencing any technical issues, that's what the chat panel is for. Please use that to let me know, and I'll troubleshoot the issue with you privately. We are using hashtag ACRL Choice Webinars today, so if you've got another screen handy, shout out to us. We're at choice_reviews on Twitter. And before we get started today, here is Barbara Olson from ProQuest with a quick message from our sponsor.
Thank you, Mark. I just wanted to take a moment to thank you all for being here today. Normally, we close with a thank you, but today we wanted to open with a thank you. And just to really thank you for your role on the front lines and to thank you for helping your users continue to learn and teach and do research in an environment none of us has experienced before. As you can imagine, we had some reservations about hosting this webinar today, but we heard loud and clear from you that you wanted it to go on as planned. So here we are, and thanks for being here with us today. Before we start and I hand it back to Mark and you get to hear from Jill, I have one really quick public service announcement, and it's really just to say that we understand that you and your institutions are being stretched in entirely new ways. Please know that ProQuest is here and ready to help. You can contact your account team or our customer service department, and please follow us on social media and check out our ProQuest homepage to learn about any programs we've got to support the coronavirus-impacted libraries. So with that, I'll hand it back to Mark, and again, thank you for being here with us today.
All right. Thank you, Barbara. And I will just do a real quick intro of Jill Jensen. This is Dr. Jill Jensen is our speaker today. She is the Visiting Assistant Professor, Business Administration and Management at the University of the Redlands. So with that, I will hand it over to Jill.
Thank you very much, Mark and Barbara. Thanks, everyone, for joining. I kind of will repeat what has already been said. This is a difficult time, but I'm going to actually address that just in a moment. As you've heard, my talk is called Women, Their Jobs, Their Lives, A History of Records, from Charlotte Perkins Gilman to the Me Too Movement. I'll explain what I mean by all those as we move forward. We are, of course, living in troubled times. In terms of health, well-being, safety, even sanity, I'd say. In a matter of days, much has changed. Yet as a historian, I well understand that others have been upended as equally as intense ways over the years. More so perhaps in truth if we think about wars, natural disasters, calamities of all sorts. But I want to comment just a bit in the beginning on teaching and preparation for and in life as we are living it now today. Recent events have taught us the importance of digital resources. We appreciated these before, of course, but especially now, as we are all in the process of moving or already having moved instruction online. There's a tenseness everywhere in society, but very much so in higher education. For professors, students, administrators, for librarians, as we enter this uncharted territory. Or perhaps this is a lesson for us. I reflect upon moments of tumultuous change, living through crises of one sort or another. I teach on it quite a bit. One does not know how things are going, and I was telling my students that the other day. When you're in the middle of the storm, you don't know where you're going. This leads to questions about whether everything will be okay soon, or if problems will lead to long-term dislocations. We will see. I'm reminded of a research project option that I crafted for students to look into the human implications of the Spanish flu on U.S. society, especially for working classes following World War I. But I don't want to divert too far from the chosen topic here. For right now, let us all just take a breath, a deep breath. So here's a picture of a different type of learning, very hands-on and in-person, housewifery lessons, taught in England. The pictures, a tutorial of sorts from 1893. These reveal tasks which are still going on in our new age of shelter in place. As children are home and families are home, home tasks should not be brushed off, as all women know, others as well. Social reproduction, as it was identified by Marx and repeated by others, are actions that sustain society, making other economic activities possible. But now we have a whole new vernacular that is surrounding this, a whole new social reality of home, a safe place. Stay safe, we say again and again, or we write it. We've been saying that and hearing it a lot. These pictures are actually from the Wellcome Library in London. If people aren't aware of it, anyone looking for fair use images, it's an incredible collection, funded initially by Sir Henry Wellcome, so that's what the name is. He was a pharmaceutical entrepreneur. And there's a lot of science and health that is in there, so it's a really very incredibly rich collection. To return, though, to the context of the webinar, I propose a discussion question incorporating the ideas that I've just mentioned a little bit. What is the availability for student research relating to women's history, particularly regarding topics of economic opportunity, social well-being, and rights to safety and security at work, as well as in society more generally? Taking a long view of history in this momentous year, a century after ratification of the 19th Amendment, offered U.S. women the right to vote on the federal level, I hope to explore with you how historical documents can help us to better understand the milestones, but also the less known evolutionary dynamics of women in the workplace and participation in the public sphere. As milestone, we can consider the fateful year between July 1919, when the U.S. Senate passed the 19th Amendment, extending into August 1920, when the state of Tennessee became the 36th to ratify, thus making women's suffrage the law in the United States. But less known events were also vital in the fight for extended opportunities for women and for their finding a just and equitable place in society. A few words about myself, just at the beginning, my teaching and my scholarship. I teach at a smaller liberal arts university in the greater Los Angeles area, the University of Redlands, a beautiful place, a caring place, pretty empty right now, but still a lovely place. I teach undergraduate courses in the history of capitalism, the history of work, labor in the global economy, and a new course I am in the process of designing, which I'm calling Sustainable Labor, the Future of Work, which looks at today's workforce, but also expectations about how we will work and be employed in the years to come. I have a PhD in the history of comparative policy and teach, as Mark said, in the Department of Business Administration and Management. And with colleagues here in my department, I'm a founding member of the Women's Institute. My academic scholarship centers around economic and labor history, the history of social policy, and the gender of economic rights as human rights, as I call it. I've written on social policy, specifically via the U.S. Women's Bureau, part of the Department of Labor, during the New Deal and later, and comparing social policies internationally, labor standards, social security, anti-discrimination policies, and others. I've written on defending gendered rights for women themselves who have worked within the United Nations as an institution that has both advocated and quietly denied women's rights, but this is a longer story, one I can't get into today. I've also written on fair trade, employment, and development alternatives for nations of the Global South, and edited a volume on efforts surrounding these topics by the International Labor Organization, which is currently an agency of the UN and works on global labor standards. I have a new project on human migration and historically concerned over what was called surplus populations. Thus, the idea from the 1960s and 70s that if women would just quote unquote work, poorer countries would rise out of poverty, as if there existed a group of women who were just sitting around, not contributing, but not directly contributing to the gross domestic product as development specialists saw it. This is actually a point I'd like to problematize, of course, and deserves a greater understanding about how women work, not just in paid positions or formal employment or jobs, although they do there, but in many, many capacities, sustaining families, communities, and nations. I'd ask that you pause for a moment and look at these maps, since they are quite special. These are just two of many that we've created that show a point-to-point migration based on data from the United Nations, collated by the World Bank. People from the Center for Spatial Studies at my university helped me to put these together, so these are crafted individually. The one on the left shows the out-migration from the Philippines, a country that sent countless economic migrants around the globe, often to labor in homes, in fields, in other kind of low-paid positions in the jobs that they could find. The one on the right, though, is interesting because it shows in-migration to South Africa. So it shows actually south-to-south or north-to-south migration, not normally the way that we think that economic migrants are going, because they're going to the industrialized areas. But South Africa, of course, if you know, is a great mining area. So particularly, there's a very dark line that is going from India to South Africa. This is in the 1980s, around the 1980s. So they were going down there to be miners. Interesting to see those different dynamics. They're quite stunning, really, and show a whole new way for us to think about human interaction, right, in mapping. Geography studies are nothing new, of course, but new geographical information systems, GIS, it's called, help us to see movement or densities or all sorts of other data in new ways. I'm excited about that project. I'm working as well on another project titled Women in Development, the Social Movement, 1919 to 2019, which will become a ProQuest database. There we look at women's economic participation and activism over an entire century. Its focus is on how women have negotiated power, status, human rights, and social inclusion through primary source documentation. So it fits quite well for the discussion here. So let me get to the specific content of our conversation about sources and history, the way that I've set it up. On the color of my slides, I found a swatch, virtual, of course, for the color sulfur. Although we probably can't read the small print on top of the screen in that swatch, that's what it says. It matched perfectly once I played around with the different paint capacities in PowerPoint. The color is not 100% agreeable in terms of aesthetics, but this is a point I am making. There are discomforts in lives. Writer, poet, novelist, and social reformer Charlotte Perkins Gilman was born in 1860 and married in 1884. After the birth of her first child, she began suffering from disruptive bouts of severe depression. And at one point, she was advised by a doctor to go through rest cure, a time of seclusion where she was not to write, to paint, to read, nor, one assumes, to think, but just rest. She could exercise for health, although. Later, she wrote of this in the famous short story, The Yellow Wallpaper, and described what proved to be a harrowing experience for a person who loved to think and above all, be engaged with others in the world. Here she is describing this yellow wallpaper which lined the room to which she was confined. The color is repellent, almost revolting, a smoldering, unclean yellow, strangely faded by the slow turning sunlight. It is a dull yet lurid orange in some places, a sticky sulfur tint in others. The story, which is both riveting and disturbing, was first published in the New England Magazine in Boston. By the way, that journal can be accessed through Happy Trust, which I will speak about in a few minutes. The author, Charlotte, then married to a man named Charles Stetson, who appears in the story as John, her husband is actually part and parcel of this story, was most likely suffering from what was called at the time neurasthenia, a catch-all phrase for mental disorder, discomfort, or unease, a whole realm of things simply thrown under its description. Problems with no cause, some thought. But of course, the women who went through these were not making things up. What today would be called postpartum depression, mental stress, clinical depression, all sorts of unsettling feelings were thrown into this same pile. In the story, Charlotte offered a powerful evaluation of the importance of a woman's emotional and physical health. Here and in her other writings, she touched on topics still debated today, from women's contribution to society to their concern for human health and psychological contentment. John tells her not to, quote, neglect proper self-control, unquote, as he calls it. She is not to express herself in speech, nor in writing, not in art, as I mentioned already. And here I pause to interject something a student of mine noted in discussion recently. He wrote to a classmate, "You only see violence as a physical thing. Physical violence is one form of violence. Economic violence, emotional violence, and moral violence are a few other forms of violence. Violence takes many forms." That's important. Extending the conversation, we can discuss women's economic participation as a nation and on a global level, and consider the immense cultural, religious, and socioeconomic challenges we still face in the fight for economic opportunities and an elevated level of quality of life. I am using women's movements here as a focus. So I will mention two excellent documentaries I often suggest to my students, both from PBS. The first, created in 2013, is called Makers, Women Who Make America. And it is about the women's movement, but in all of its divisions, as well as its common purpose. It catches differences of opinions based upon race and racism, class and classism, differences of economic experiences, and gender and sexuality, of identities, of lesbians, bis, or others, and how they fit in or did not fit in to the women's movement per se, particularly third wave feminism. The second is more recent, and a story of women's advocates, a shelter movement that began in 1974. It is subtitled Walking with Survivors, and interviews women who made the difficult choice to leave homes and places of physical protection, and for places of physical protection, and then the challenges they faced in light of these decisions. In reference to all that have been through treatment, for those who have suffered mental anguish, perhaps not the physical side of abuse, although as I mentioned, lines can be blurred, if we step back into the story of the yellow wallpaper for a moment, we can feel the frustration. Charlotte wrote, "So I take phosphites, whichever it is, and tonics, and journeys, and air, and exercise, and I am absolutely forbidden to work until I am well again." Personally, I disagree with their ideas. Personally, I believe that congenial work with excitement and change could do me good, but what is one to do? And then later she wrote, John does not know how much I really suffer. He knows there is no reason to suffer, and that satisfies him. So we as the reader are frustrated, along with the writer. We feel her being stifled, talked down to, ignored. Gilman subsequently divorced Stetson and married a cousin, George Houghton Gilman. Both these moves led to social ostracism. She was never healthy, really, but worked all her life from there on out, and she made by, hoped. Since she was divorced, she needed to support herself. She did so by lecturing and through publishing many books of poetry, fiction, and one of the few nonfiction books she published called Women and Economics, a study of economic relations between men and women as a factor of social evolution. A long title, but I think it is telling what she is trying to do. Consider what social evolution would entail. It has been called variously her manifest and her most influential book. In it, she wrote, "In spite of the power of the individual will to struggle against conditions, to resist them for a while, and sometimes to overcome them, it remains true that the human creature is affected by environment, and is as is every other living thing. We all must deal in the world that we face. Past or present does not change that. Women did so with unequal power, certainly in the 1890s. Is this true as well today? How do women, or those who define themselves of various gender for that matter, negotiate power and opportunity? How do they, we, speaking from my own perspective, make our way?" And here now to draw on contemporary women's movement, I think of Me Too. When activist Tarana Burke started the Me Too campaign more than 10 years ago, wrote journalist Anna North on Vox Media recently, her goal was to spread a message for survivors. You're heard. You're understood. So although Me Too has evolved and become something of all sorts to all sorts of women, it had racial and class dimensions from the beginning. That protection is often premised on resources, and that women of color, the other, are often overlooked. Burke notes that Me Too is not for her about retribution. Not against Harvey Weinsteins of the world today. It's about healing, about care, about camaraderie. Movements are complicated. These are living things. And here I note the exploration of the complexities of women's movements in the plural, and also their global reach. We could call this universality, but in truth, there is not one, but many, perhaps maybe even unlimited renditions to the question, what do women want? The picture on the left here are women going to the League of Nations. The League of Nations was a precursor of sort to the United Nations, to debate what was called from 1919 on the status of women. And there were countless studies in the 1920s into the 1930s about what the status of women meant. The picture on the right, more currently, shows women at the debate in the United Nations. And you can see right there, the woman on the right is the chair of the Commission for the Status of Women. Became a reality after the end of World War II. The conversation on status continues. The status of woman was status, as we might interpret it today, being power or positions, right? But also legal treatment, property rights, citizenship rights, all of which tied to a husband once a woman was married. Importantly, though, the women involved also pointed to the right to vote as a voice, a public voice. This was an international campaign. I'd like to point that out. So here's a cartoon, which I love to teach with. Should women vote? You can see all sorts of little representations in this picture. This is a cartoon from the Library of Congress database. You see the man politics out there, the woman in chains, her arm, her head on her arm, kind of in the middle of toil, perhaps exhaustion or agitation or anguish, we don't know, and sort of the corrupt forces that are all around her headed to the voting polls. A little bit of a kind of play on this idea, but still that there was an irony to this whole thing, that women were kept away from the vote. On the national stage, we know the story, correct? Right? Of several generations of suffrage advocates from Seneca Falls in 1848, with the penning of the Declaration of Sentiments by Elizabeth Cady Stanton and support by Susan B. Anthony on the far on the top of the slide left. I could have added a picture of Carrie Chapman Catt, right? Younger than Stanton and Anthony, but still older than Alice Paul, who is pictured in the middle. We know her as the more radical, a suffragette, as she was called, which actually began kind of as a disparaging word, but they embraced it and decided that it was what they were all about. In the 1910s, Paul led a new campaign for women's voting on the federal level, finally, successfully, after 70 years, right? We don't hear much, but maybe you have, about Inez Mulholland. She's the picture, she's the woman in the center of the picture on the bottom. A labor lawyer, by the way, a socialist, and a suffragist. She died on the campaign trail in 1916, sort of a martyr for the cause. She had underlying other health ailments. In fact, she was the public face for the suffragists in the later era, famously leading parades on the back of a white horse, a warrior for justice. But historical records also help us unpack the complications behind women's suffrage, as opposed to just a success. The History Vault has several collections, including an excellent one focused on women's rights, with records from Paul and the Women's Party, which, by the way, she had an international arm to as well. This is where I also found examples of the anti-suffrage review, showing that not all women or men found the idea of women's vote appealing. These are not just legal issues, although they are legal, but there's more to it. There's more to it, and this is what I'm arguing, is that they are cultural as well. And perhaps this helps us understand other times and habits and assumptions. On the right is a set of clippings shown as a new campaign on the road, speaking series, as it were, of suffragists just out of prison, if you know the story. After their dramatic hunger strike, finally pressed President Woodrow Wilson in support of the 19th Amendment, which he had refused to endorse prior. 19th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution for the right for the federal vote for women. Wilson, fearing a public relations catastrophe if those women had died in prison on their hunger strike, under duress, at the end of an earth-shattering world war, an outbreak of the Spanish flu or influenza pandemic, which lasted from January 18 until December 20th, 1920, felt there was no other option. It's a good story for historians, sounds kind of dramatic, but what about other women? We can find pictures of African-American women in the records fighting for racial justice and the vote, as in the case here from the Library of Congress photographs collection. There's an excellent article on the Smithsonian Magazine, an essay by Martha Jones on the intersection of race and voting rights campaign. She uses this picture on it. That's what alerted me to it. Or working class women. So away from a narrow focus on those middle class reformers that I mentioned before, I think of Clara Beyer, the woman on the left, who will be covered pretty extensively in the Women in Development database for her efforts in international development programs from the 1930s to the 1980s, you can believe it, an incredible career. In 1919, Beyer was running around Washington, D.C. with Elizabeth Brandeis, holding employers accountable, asking them to open up their ledgers, demanding statistics on payrolls, and comparing these to family budgets during a minimum wage campaign for women and children in certain industries. This is going on the same time as the vote, the fight for the vote. Beyer and Brandeis were forced to share one position on the minimum wage board since the city would not hire two of them, as they checked on real wages for women in factory settings. Of course, in 1923, the US Supreme Court ruled that the DC minimum wage law for women violated due process clause of the Fifth Amendment because it abridged a citizen's right to freely contract labor. Sigh, right? Back to the drawing board, and with women sometimes starving. On the right is Beyer again, with Frances Perkins, in their advocacy for all workers. Society could do better with health, justice, and fair wages, they both felt. That was their life campaign. And what about the story after or even before 1920 in the final ratification? What's the kind of deeper context that we can get out of people's own experiences with political realities, old and new, in different states? We can look to records on Happy Trust Digital Library, which is a treasure trove, if you don't know about it, of records about more localized aspects, like this one, on the political status of women in the United States, with more context, more nuance, right, than just the secondary literature. On this reality, we can learn from documents found through the Women in Social Movements database, for sure. Here's a photo with a caption of 1,500 colored women to vote in Harlem District. Suffragists are organizing. And we can learn more about local efforts leading up to 1919, here in 1917. But there's also an essay on how women were disenfranchised in Jim Crow South, just as Black men were with poll taxes and literacy tests, among other things. The story, if not of ultimate success, is about the continuation of the struggle. From online records, we can also see the international campaigns I mentioned before, with the forging of transnational women's networks. Here, the International Alliance for Women, Suffrage, and Legal Citizenship, so it's back to that citizen issue, later shortened to the International Women's Suffrage Alliance. Started in 1904, and of course, lasted for a long time. Four events which we can find context access through the Women and Social Movements International database on the Second International Conference of Socialist Women at Copenhagen in 1910, or many other gatherings of women's groups, unions, NGOs, as they would be known today. I start with that event in 1910, since it was the impetus of International Women's Day, which we just celebrated on March 8th. It was there in Copenhagen where Clara Zetkin, leader of the Women's Office for the Social Democratic Party in Germany, proposed the idea of an International Women's Day, a day to press for the demands of greater rights and opportunities for women. International Women's Day reminds us sort of the radical nature of what is going on, but also the worker side, right? Also the unions, also the economic side for women's call. Fast forward to 1975, and the Commission for the Status of Women called for the organization within the UN and including all sorts of women's groups to stage the first World Conference on Women to coincide with International Women's Year. The World Conference of the International Women's Year was held in Mexico City in July of 1975, with 133 governments participating and 6,000 NGO representatives attending a parallel forum called the International Women's Year Tribune. The focus of the conference was on women, but also in the report of the World Conference on International Women's Year, which can be accessed through the UN, United Nations Digital Library, they also outlined the other concerns. It was about development, about peace, so poverty, violence, and health as issues of concern to all women. The conference stimulated the call for the United Nations Decade of Women, 1976 to 85, which really saw many, many international campaigns moving forward. It was really a moment of reckoning with some of these ideas that had been bubbling below the surface ever since Charlotte Perkins Gilman and others. I had many different ideas for this talk, but since I can't get through everything, I will kind of sum up with a little bit of an evaluation of this document, a find in the archives that I went to recently. So if you take a moment and look at this, I was in the Rockefeller Archive Center in Sleepy Hollow, New York. And this is records from the Agricultural Development Council, which is one of the Rockefeller philanthropies. What it is, the document comes out of the picture that I'm going to talk about for a moment, comes out of the Fourth World Congress of Rural Society, evaluating the Fourth World Congress of Rural Society in Poland in 1976. It represents one of many, many different discussions about women on the global scale that really came after that 1975 conference. Now suddenly a focus of study of social scientists, of development specialists thinking about this. And if you look at the picture on the far right, I think it's very telling. It's about how women negotiate economy. I'll give another slide that shows it a little bit closer up. We think of a person and paid employment and the market. So that's where they get their money, is you think of a job. But look at the complicated network that this woman, this is taken from a study of rural Norway. She and the household in the middle are not just negotiating paid employment in the market. They're going to the sea to fish. They're going to the forest to forge. They're going to the farm to grow. And all of these things interact with one another in a very kind of complicated, but actually in the lives of women and men, for that matter, people of all sorts, we know that there are these complications, right? That there's these interactions on various stages. And even though today, maybe it's not the sea or the forest or the farm, although it could be your network of family, of friends, of social institutions, right? Your church, your synagogue, your temple. It could be neighbors, neighborhood organizations, the YM or the YWCA, you know, schools and community, all of these things that are here. So here are some pictures that are taken from a recent study. I think this is on a site from the White House, talking about female labor force participation rates, right? And where they're more dense and where they're less dense. I think it's also a cultural aspect that is there. You know, then the bottom, female labor force participation rates, GDP capital. In a certain sense, these are important and we can evaluate them, but I think if we think back to the more complicated nature about the way women interact with economy and society, it really is a bigger story to tell. Community. It's about community, and I think community is something that we are really thinking about today, virtual or not. So the way that women have used these international institutions and engaged with them and pressed them forward for issues of peace, and here's a picture of disarmament, but also the idea of social justice for both women and for men, and for working women and for men, and children for that matter, in this idea of women, their lives, history of records. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm just actually looking at the, thank you, Jill, that was really interesting. I'm looking at the Q&A. I don't see any questions in there, but if I want to give participants a moment to certainly type in a question for Jill about her content or about her research or scholarship.
And I could speak a little longer if we don't get any questions.
Sure. Yeah. Feel free to do that, and I will let you know if we get any questions.
Okay. Should I just talk for a little while?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, so what I was thinking of, what I could talk about, and this was, I was just supposing that maybe there might be a question or two about this, but is ways to engage students in these kind of evaluations of primary source documents. When I teach undergrads, and you know, oftentimes trying to think about what is primary source and what is secondary source, and they come into classes and they don't quite understand it, but it doesn't take very long for them to understand it. And I think it's, you know, so wonderful when they get a primary source document and they can think about it and evaluate it. And I think that there's a richness to this. So I would encourage anybody to be pressing, you know, librarians, you know, other academics and such, teachers of all sorts, community colleges, goodness, this can go back to high school, of course, very, very richly, thinking about how we can put students into that time and that place of those struggles for women as they were evaluating some of these, you know, complications, but also opportunities, I'll have to say. It's not a story completely of pain and suffering. It's also a story of accomplishment, you know, empowerment as the years go by. But I also will say that it is still a story in the making. Right. That's why I like that documentary, Women Who Make the World, make women who are making this situation be what it is and how they are evaluating it. So primary source documents, and there's so many different places that we could go to find them. You know, the ProQuest has an incredible, wonderful collection of these, but so too are some of these other sources that you can go to and have students explore those, and they can find them themselves. As they're putting together some of their research projects. A really interesting one that I had, I mentioned that about the Spanish influenza following 1918, was taking a novel and reading a novel and having events that occurred and having the students go to the primary source documents and research those events and see who had lived through them. So we're hearing the voice of the author, but we're also hearing the voice of some of the people that were there in the real life situation. So some of those kind of, you know, ways to think about opening up the conversation and being creative about how we are engaging with history and with and the way that students engage with it. Any questions?
No questions. So again, thank you, Jill. I really appreciate the time and effort that you put into building this webinar today, and thank you for everybody who joined us this afternoon. Mark, did you have any closing comments that you wanted to share with the group?
Yes, I would just say, as you have said, thank you so much today, Jill, for the presentation. Really interesting stuff. Great presentation. And I would just remind attendees that we did record the session today, and that, you know, in about 24 hours or so, you should get a link to that recording. So please be on the lookout for that email from ACRL and Choice. I would also mention that you should see in the chat box there a link to a quick survey. If you could take just a minute or two to fill that out to let us know how we did today, we would really appreciate your doing so. And I would just say to everyone out there, thank you so much for your time today. We hope that this that you enjoyed the session and that you maybe learned a little bit too. All right. Okay. Thanks, everyone. We will talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.